please welcome to the show Mike Papantonio. He is senior partner at a law firm called Levin Papantonio. He is one of the largest plaintiff lawyers in the United States, taking care of cases against big pharma, tobacco, weapon manufacturers, and other bastions of corporate greed. But the reason we're going to be speaking with him today is about one of his new books. He has written about, I don't know, I lost count, 10 books or something in the fiction space, legal type thrillers, but he's also written some interesting books that caught my eye. One is called In Search of Atticus Finch, a book about how to be a lawyer, which I think would be fascinating. Mike, welcome to the show. How are you doing today?
Good, Jim. How are you doing?
I am well. Who is the greatest literary lawyer out there? Is it Atticus Finch? Is he our greatest?
I would say so.
Lawyer?
Yeah, I would say so. He's had a big impact on a lot of lawyers over the years because, you know, he had all those parts. His family mattered to him, his profession mattered to him, his community mattered to him, and he wasn't afraid to jump into those tough cases. And a lot of times with lawyers these days especially, I don't know what it is, I don't know whether it's a generational thing or what, but you find that lawyers are just unwilling to move outside of their comfort zone. Kind of before we got on, I was telling you about your book, School of Startups. That was one of the themes. You have to move outside your comfort zone. And Atticus Finch was somebody that always operated out of his comfort zone. But nevertheless, he had all those moving parts. Great father.
So how many books is it? Is it 8, 9 books?
No,
how many fiction?
Okay, so four fiction and 3 nonfiction. Yeah.
Okay.
Yeah.
All 4 lawyers are about lawyers.
Yeah, the first books that were the nonfiction books, they were actually kind of instructional, like you did with School of Startups, which is to tell people that there are things that you ought to think about when you in your career want to do some remarkable things. And so they talked to lawyers about that. For some reason, right at the first few years of my practice, I was hitting very big verdicts in very difficult areas. And so I was called on to give speeches about what is it that you did different. And so out of there came those 3 books, In Search of Atticus Finch, Resurrecting Aesop, and Clarence Darrow, The Journeyman. And they were just really, they talked about the same thing, Jim, that you talked about in your books, and that there are some things that you need to be able to embrace and say, I need to change this aspect of what I do. And one of the constant themes, as I say, that you seem to have some kinship with is you can't be afraid of rejection, and you can't be afraid to try that new thing.
I'm a great dater, Mike, because I don't have any fear of rejection. Thousands of girls have said no to me.
Yeah,
so.
Yeah, it's law of it's kind of law of averages, isn't it?
That's right. You only need one to say yes.
Yes, that's correct.
And I found 2. So yeah.
Before school, I sold books door to door. In many summers, University of Florida, they had it. It was a big program. You'd go out all over the country and sell books, Bibles, and children's books in areas that you know, completely foreign to you. But you would make so much money. And I found that the greatest closers, the people who really could close a deal, once they forgot that it was all about law of averages, they just fell apart. And that's just true with everything we do, isn't it? Whether writing a book, like, you know, sometimes these books work, sometimes they don't. I think this one, Inhuman Trafficking, is going to work.
So men either want their own restaurant bar, they want a great American novel, or 21-year-old twins. I guess your dream was to write the great American legal thriller.
Yeah, we're all, you know what, it really didn't start out like that, and I don't know that it's there yet, but the problem is the cases that I handle, Jim, are just, they're not, you know, I don't do 1-800-AUTO-CRASH or come see me for workers' compensation, the kind of cases I did. That, matter of fact, the tobacco litigation started right here with my law firm. We helped write it and launched it in the United States. The opioid case that's going on right now, we launched that case. We've probably launched 44 of the biggest pharmaceutical cases in the country, 12 of the biggest environmental cases. So every time you're doing that, you have to say, well, this is, you know, taking on big tobacco. God, I think we were $28 million into that before we could turn it around. On opioids, I think, were probably similar amount of money. So the point is
to make sure that we understand, you spent close to $30 million prosecuting the case.
Oh, of course. Yeah, of course.
So I don't think most people would know that. Where does money like that come from?
Well,
obviously, you have corporate support.
No, not at all. We don't take any loans from Wall Street. Most of the time, we're suing Wall Street. We just had some big breaks, Jim. Early on, I tried some of the first asbestos cases ever tried in America. And, it was such an awful case. They were killing blue-collar workers by the thousands, literally. And, we came across some documents that were just the worst. One document said these men make a good living with asbestos. They can die with asbestos. You can imagine what juries did to react to that. So I had a whole run of very successful trials. And so we've always been fortunate. I mean, this firm's always been fortunate. We've called a few wrong, but not often. But again, getting back to your theory, some things you have to do and you don't have, sometimes you don't have a roadmap, right? You just don't have it. There is no roadmap that's laid out. There's no template that says, here's how you get to Cobra Street or whatever it may be. Here's how you get there. Doesn't happen. You got to write your own template.
All right. So this year's thriller, Inhuman Trafficking, what's the case? And what's the book?
Yeah, so
how close is the real case to the book?
Oh,
give us the whole rundown.
It's very close. We filed a case up in Ohio for a national case. It was had to do with human trafficking, and in there, in the cases that we're filing now, we're filing. Let me give an example. Girls are trafficked from L.A. to the East Coast. They're brought in semi-trucks where they split up the trucks into maybe 7-8 kind of bedroom areas behind an 18-wheeler. They stop at truck stops along the way. They call ahead, hey, we've got 14 and 15-year-olds that are coming in. You can have sex with them and leave. That goes on. It's a huge industry. That's one of the cases that we're handling. Another case we're handling is where you have probably the biggest pornographer in the world, called MindGeek. They're out of California. Well, out of Canada. And so they needed financing, right? Because it takes big money to do what they do. So they get, and these people rely heavily on traffickers, heavily, heavily on traffickers. So while they were being investigated up in Canada, Parliament actually had them in questioning them and cross-examining them. It didn't stop Wall Street from coming in and giving them huge loans, even though they understood that what that trafficker did, Jim, is they would call that porn entity called MindGeek would call traffickers and they'd say, hey, we need a film. This is what we're looking for. And the trafficker would put five girls in a hotel room and they would film whatever needed to be filmed. And for 2 weeks, you know, you'd be at a place called like a Marriott or, you know, a main chain hotel where the folks at the hotel act like nothing's going on. And, you know, cameras are being brought in. Lights are being brought in. These girls are walking around the premises for 2 weeks. And everybody says, well, hell, I mean, I didn't know what was going on. So, I mean, you know, it's such an ugly process. And we think of a movie like Taken, which, by the way, was a good movie. But it doesn't tell the picture. We handle those kind of cases. It's called a recruiter case. A recruiter goes to the Ukraine and they tell these girls, hey, how would you like to work in the United States and learn the guest industry? So they bring them over here. They put them in a restaurant greeter for a week. And then they say, oh, by the way, we have a strip club right down the road. Would you like to work in there because you'll make more money? So they put them as a greeter there. And then they say to them, hey, you know, we got these poles. You want to dance on the pole because you can make five times what you're making now. And then they put them on the pole. And it's called a step up. And then the next thing that happens, hey, Tom here wants to meet you. And when Tom meets him, it's all over. because Tom is the trafficker. So this book talks about all of those. It doesn't do it in a, you know, it's not a preachy book, Jim. It's just a story. But it incorporates all of these stories because, well, I'm real familiar with them because I'm in the middle of doing it. Right now, as we speak, we have depositions getting ready to start on these kinds of cases. So it's
who are the bad guys and the good guys? I mean, who's out there to kill who?
Well, I mean, that's the issue. We think the bad guy is some cat that is some pimp that has four or five girls working for him, and that's all there is to it. The bad guys are the enablers. You know, there was a time, for example, in the Atlanta airport, where Atlanta was used as a centerpiece.
There are signs now all over the Atlanta airport.
Well,
about that.
You know why there are signs? Because
we used to be the number one center.
That's
supposedly.
Exactly right. And until they found out we were going after them years ago. I mean, it's been for years now. And so, what they would do, Jim, is they would bring in people, these underage girls from all over the world. They'd put them in a hotel room for a week or so. People would fly into Atlanta, have sex with these underage girls and leave, and then the girls would be shipped back to where they came from, if they're lucky. Sometimes they weren't. Sometimes they were put into just a slavery encampment. You know, people have no idea how bad this is, man. I mean, you know, it just doesn't affect them until it affects them. You know, you'd be amazed at the number of cases we have where these girls come from, you know, middle America, man. I mean, you know, they were high school cheerleaders, and the next thing you know, they're strung out on opioids and they're human trafficked. So I don't know why we have one reason that we're so in the dark is because corporate America, corporate media, those folks, NBC, CBS, ABC, they don't tell these stories anymore because advertisers a lot of times don't let them. How are they going to tell the story about a Wall Street fund that's funding this type of thing if the Wall Street fund is actually advertising and spending $10 million a year, or hotel chain spending $10 million a year? You're not going to have MSNBC cover a story like I used to do MSNBC. I used to be a contributor for MSNBC for years with a guy named Ed Schultz. I don't know if you remember Ed, but he called him Big Red. He was a
I do, yeah.
Yeah, well, Ed, dear friend of mine, and we used to do the show together, and we'd be getting ready to do a story. It might be a story about Bear making a product that's killing people, and I'd be in the short count, 10, 9, 8, 7. Pap, you got to change the story. And then they throw me something inane like, constitutional law, whatever it may be. So corporate media is dead. It's dead and dying where it comes to telling stories like we're talking about here, about human trafficking. Or the opioid crisis. The opioid crisis, that's another case I'm handling now. It only happened because corporate media would not tell the story and regulators wouldn't get involved. So what I found is the best way sometimes to tell the story is with fiction. You know, it's not preachy. It's not, doesn't look like a textbook. It's just telling a story. And the story, by the end of the time they're finished with it, you know, you go, wow, it's a good story, but I learned something. I came away. I didn't know this. I didn't know this was true. And so I think every book I've written has that theme to it, whether it was the first book I ever wrote had to do with a product that DuPont was making that you're going to hear more and more about. It's called C8, PFAS. Well, hell, it's killing people all over the world. I mean, it's in your drinking water, for God's sakes.
What is it?
It's a fluorocarbon. And if you I have zero doubt right now as we speak, I have zero doubt that it's in your drinking water. It causes liver cancer, causes testicular cancer, causes birth defects. And DuPont and 3M, two of the biggest corporations in the country, were allowed to continue putting it in the water. It got in your aquifer and ended up in your drinking water. Well, you know how many years ago we tried to tell that story? There's a great movie out. Go watch it. It's called The Devil We Know. It's about this story. It's where they followed me around for a year and a half and told the story. And still, even as we speak, corporate America, corporate media doesn't tell that story because their advertisers will get angry with them and they'll cut back their money. I mean, for God's sakes, now Bear and 3M, what if you got a call from 3M and you're MSNBC barely hanging on and you get a call from an advertiser that says, hey, we're going to pull the ad because you want to run this story. What do? They pull the story. What does the regulator do? The regulator takes the low road because he's told, hey, if you help us with this, when you come out of there, we're going to give you a job. We're going to pay you four times what you're making as a bureaucratic regulator. Where do you think that goes? So these stories, these books, the first one was called Law and Disorder. The second was called Law and Vengeance. The next one was called Law and Addiction. This was called Inhuman Trafficking. They all center around these cases that I'm talking about. And again, my goal is not to be, you know, preachy or sound like a college professor. It's to educate them while they're being entertained. You can grab one, lay out at the beach, read it in a day, and come away and you've learned something. Hopefully you've been entertained.
I can't believe you won't tell. Is there a, who's the good guy, though? Is there a hero?
In the book. There's a lot of heroes. There's a lot of heroes.
Are you the hero in the book?
No,
Are you writing about yourself, Mike?
There's a character named Deke, and everybody says, well, Pap, you know, you wrote it about yourself. Deke is a composite, Jim. He's not, you know, there's no definite lines. It's not good or bad.
He's a composite of all seven of your personalities?
No schizophrenia involved. He's a composite of some of the best lawyers and some of the worst lawyers I've met in my career. You know, too often the author goes, let me create this superhero. Deke is not a superhero. He's simply human. I mean, my God, he's a hugely successful lawyer that's got gremlins just like everybody else has got. The last book I created, I think, a really interesting character. Most people have never even heard what a PJ is. They're called a pararescue man. And this pararescue man named Michael comes to work with the law firm. And he's a lawyer that doesn't really play by the rules because he wasn't trained to play by the rules. He was trained to jump out of airplanes at 40,000 feet out of a halo jump, swim 2 miles to shore, and then rescue somebody who's being held a prisoner. That's what a PJ is. They train them right down the road from where I live at the Air Force Base. They're just bad, bad cats. I mean, the way they pick them is they say, we want somebody who can operate independently without a team and go get it done. And so he's a character I think you'll really like here, Jim. He's just an interesting character that's been added to it. And then some of the old characters have been brought. Carol Morris, who's a private investigator. A couple of other folks that, you know, on the face, they're totally dysfunctional, but they're great lawyers. So it mixes it all up.
Do you follow closely then the media legal cases as fodder for the next book? Are we going to get a book soon about Epstein and his relationship with some prince?
Well, you know what? That stuff bores the hell out of me by about week three. It's not getting rid of bad chemicals in my food.
It doesn't compare.
Exactly. So the next book you're going to hear about, it's an interesting topic. It has to do with, we're handling a case, one of the biggest cases in the country, against banks who are washing money for terrorists, okay? These are banks that have already pled guilty to funding terrorism, and they understand exactly what the causation connections are. We had an attorney general, for God's sakes, Eric Holder under Obama, who let these people sign a document, pay HSBC. They paid $1.2 billion. They signed a document.
Yeah, I remember that. And admitted,
yeah, we know we killed some people. Yeah, we know we gave money to terrorists. But, gee, Eric, could you just slap us on the hand? So they paid $1.2 billion. They made $20 billion washing money for terrorists. That's our new norm in this country, Jim. That's the new norm. So that's the next thing you're going to be reading about coming from me. It's about the terrorist case, and it's really interesting. It's an interesting case.
I'm currently following this Murdoch family in South Carolina. You got to think that he killed his wife and his son, don't you? I mean, what else is there?
It sure points that way. That would be a great book. It's not the kind of thing I write, but it would be a great book. Because there's, you know, anytime you hear facts where you can conclude, you know, come on. This is what happened. It makes for a good story because it's intuitive, isn't it? I mean, you intuitively, you're turning chapter to chapter, and you know, okay, this is making sense. sometimes the difficulty with the books that I write is people are so far removed from the realities behind it, you see. We want to believe that we're safe from corporations that sometimes are nothing short of sociopaths. I mean, there's the only way you can describe it. Most of the time I'm in depositions or in trial, and I'm across across the table from a true-to-life sociopath. And if I had a DSM-4 and I was going, check, yeah, they have this quality, check, they have this quality, they would line up for every element of being a sociopath, no question about it. So the point—
Are you talking about the CEO
all the way to the top, Jim. Well,
So you look at Facebook right now, Mike, do you think that everyone at Facebook deserves to be in jail?
Totally. My God, look what they're doing to you or me. Yeah. Jim,
poor 9-year-old daughter who's allowed to use it.
Of course.
What stupid parent does
of
that?
How are you going to stop it? Look, here's where, in this way, you ask about the CEO. In America, especially, we look at a CEO and he's wearing an Armani suit. Okay, he's got a Rolex watch. He's got a Bentley that he drove up in for the deposition or the trial. We look at that person and we can't see them as a criminal because they don't look like a criminal. They don't look like the cat out on 4th Avenue with a hoodie on that's selling packages of marijuana that might end up in prison for the rest of their lives. We treat that person differently. We say, hey, you just pay a big fine, brother. You know, you're a white-collar criminal. Eric Holder was the worst attorney general that I have had in my lifetime that allowed white-collar criminals to get away with the kind of stuff we're talking about. They did. So let's take a case like the terrorism case, right? The terrorism case. They pay $1.2 billion. It's only a cost of doing business. Nobody's perp-walked. Nobody goes to prison. How about the opioid case right now? 150 people died every day and are still dying every day. It's manslaughter. You heard anybody going to prison about that?
And that's the Sackler family, right?
Well, it's not just the Sackler. You know, the Sackler family was the low-hanging fruit. The part of the case I handled was the distributors, you know, the big distributors. And but you know,
you mean like CVS? Is that what you mean?
Well, no, CVS is being tried by a good friend of mine right now, and he's going to really hammer them up in Ohio. There's parts to that case. The pharmacy case with CVS, Walmart, Walgreen, you know, Rite Aid. The part I handled was the distributors. The AmerisourceBergen, Cardinal, McKesson, the people who actually delivered. They were the delivery guys. But the point here, so that case is covered pretty well in the last book I wrote. It's called Law and Addiction. It's a great book. I hate to sit here. I know when I've got a good book. That was a good book. I mean, it just lays the whole opioid story out. And I mean, you know, people. I mean, my God, I could name 12 families that lost their brother, lost their son, lost their daughter to overdoses. And it's just, but nevertheless, we look at that and say, well, no, they don't look like criminals, man. They drive a nice car. They have an MBA from Yale. How could they be a criminal?
Mike, very, very quickly, give me your process for writing a book. You're a little bit busy with your legal career taking down the Titans. So how do you actually have time to do this? When do you fit it in? What's process?
Yeah, so I leave.
Long yellow legal pad. Clinton.
You got it, brother. I've got a lot of advantages. I can walk out of a courtroom and have a chapter done because what happened in that courtroom was so damn interesting. I can walk out and have a chapter. The book writes itself, truthfully. Because it's real time, Jim. It's really happening. I'm really having this hearing. I'm really having this happen with this CEO in a deposition. I'm really dealing with this regulatory bureaucrat idiot. So all that's every day. And so the book kind of writes the book writes itself because of that, you know?
How do we find out more? Get a copy of everything.
Yeah, any bookstore, Amazon. I always, you know, Amazon's an easy source. There's all kind. It's going to be everywhere in about another week or so. But you know, Amazon's the quick. You know, you quick delivery, I guess, best price. Yep. I don't know. And I think you'll like it.
All of them are five-star rated with 70, 60, 50 reviews. So I'm sure this one will be up there for you as well. Brand new out.
Jim, give yourself a prop. Give yourself a prop for School of Starters. It's a good book. School for Startups. It's a good book.
Oh, thank you. Yeah, it's gotten 100 five-star reviews. Oh, 125 star reviews. Yeah. And hopefully it's changed some people's lives, getting them off the sofa. I just want people to get off the sofa, Mike, and destroy the remote control of their own life.
Let's set another one. You and I'll just talk about that. I know a lot about that topic.
I'd love to.
All right, Jim. Thanks a lot, man. I appreciate it.
Thank you.